Okay, everyone, now it's time for our last tutorial for today. In the last tutorial, we're gonna have Flor, which is a system that I'm very fond of. This system is gonna help you when you're in your development process for machine learning, and especially with experimentation, because it's gonna help you to track your experiments and to be able to better reproduce them. The tutorial is gonna be presented by Rolando Garcia. He's a grad student in the Rice Lab.
Thank you, Yanel. So thanks again, everyone, for being here. As I'm sure you've worked throughout the entire day in the tutorial, you've had the opportunity to train models with Ray, tune them with Tune, and then recently you've seen how to deploy them with Clipper. This talk is gonna focus more on the explainability angle. So we're gonna try to focus on being able to interpret the artifacts and entities that are involved in the machine learning lifecycle, as well as the relationships between these entities. So machine learning is the enabling technology behind decision-based applications and services. I'm sure none of you will find it as a surprise that machine learning is everywhere. We see it very frequently, and as time goes on, we're probably gonna start seeing it more and more often. But these machine learning applications depend on models for their proper behavior, on predictions. And models are part of the machine learning lifecycle. So in the machine learning lifecycle, at the very beginning, we start by building a pipeline. Then we take that pipeline and we run it to train a model. And then once we have sufficient confidence in the model, we deploy it out into a prediction serving system, as you've seen. And zooming in a little more detail, let's start with the first phase. So pipeline development is an iterative and empirical process. We see a data scientist who is working with a snapshot of offline training data. And the first thing they're gonna do is shaping it. So we're gonna do some cleaning, we're gonna do some pre-processing. And it's gonna be very important that we understand the data that we're working with and that we gain sufficient insight. So is there any correlation between the columns? Are there any extreme outliers that could hurt the performance and so on? And once we've gone through this process, which we know is tedious and very time consuming, it's gonna be time for model design. We're gonna make decisions such as, are we gonna use a naive Bayes classifier or a neural network? If we're gonna use a neural network, how many neurons per layer, how many layers, and so on. Then we're gonna train and validate on these decisions. We're gonna train the models and validate the decisions that we've made. And the result of this process is gonna be a training pipeline that automates a lot of the work that we've done. But are we really ever satisfied with the first thing that we try? This is the whole iterative and empirical story, right? We're going to go over the cycle over and over and over again. So we're gonna be generating a lot of versions, whether we track them or not. So here we can already see a motivation or a great need for having a system that automatically versions and keeps a record of the things that we've tried in the past so that we can just focus our attention on exploring different alternatives and not have to worry about the recording, logging, and versioning, and so on. So that was a pipeline authoring story. A lot of people here, most of the time, don't have to worry about authoring pipelines. Instead, a lot of people can work on a pipeline that has already been built or developed, and it has been tested over many different years. And the focus here is on tuning certain hyperparameters or configuring the pipeline. Maybe you might want to insert a circle somewhere in between, add some transformations and so on. So the focus here is on modification rather than authoring. Context is still going to be extremely important for this kind of pipeline specialization because we're going to want to be able to identify common patterns, and if we can abstract them away for a class of users, that would reduce a lot of repetitive work. So regardless of how we come about the training pipeline, the next step is going to be to run it to train a model. And model training is going to involve optimizing over a very large space of possibilities. Here, a data engineer, could be the same person, just exercising a different set of skills, is going to use live data, which is going to be much more fresh and of significantly larger scale, to tune the hyperparameters of the model and be able to find a configuration that is fit for the problem. At the end of training, which could take a long time, we're going to have models that are validated on new data. Here, it's going to be extremely important that we respect and preserve the relationship between the data that was used to train the models, as well as the hyperparameters that we explored. So whenever the model, if there's a problem with the model, or we're doing some kind of debugging in production, It will be very instructive for us to be able to look at the data that trained the model in order to be able to track problems, in addition to the code. In terms of hyperparameters, every time that we're training a model or different versions of the model, if we collect the information of the hyperparameters and the score associated with that hyperparameter configuration, then we're going to have some, you could say, heuristic information about how we might warm start future training sessions. So collecting this information once we've already had it is going to be very useful. Finally, we're going to take some collection of these models and we're going to put them out into production. Model serving, as you've heard in the previous talk, requires low latency predictions, and then it's also going to require regular updates to the models. Here, an application engineer will be responsible for using and connecting the logic that composes or connects the experiments. End user applications will then query the prediction serving system and receive predictions. Clipper, for example, is a system that specializes in this domain. But as we know, machine learning models are perishable items. Over time, for whatever reason, it could be distribution in the data set, changes in schemas and whatnot, the prediction power of the model will decline. And then we'll have to take a step back and retrain a new model. Here's again a high-level overview of the machine learning lifecycle that I've described. And I hope I've made apparent that there's a lot of different and complex entities involved. We see training data, training pipelines, and many different versions of the pipelines, a vast space of possible hyperparameters and configurations for training a model, as well as an associated score. Many different people who are collaborating, maybe people are building different pipelines, and there could be an opportunity for reuse, and there's also an opportunity for eliminating work duplication. And then finally, there's the trained models that are moving throughout the life cycle. And some models are going to be in training, some models might be a year, 2 years old in production, and being able to track where they are in this part of the life cycle so we know when to update them and so on is going to be very important. So far I've explained like some of the important factors about context and why we might care about it. But if we're tracking context, what are some of the things that we might be able to do? If we identify some problem with the training data and we have context, if we know who are the producers of the data, we might be able to fix a data set rather than having to abandon it because it's not working properly. When we're considering all of these different versions of the training pipelines, it's very possible that it's not going to be the last thing that worked the best. And so being able to check out something from the past in a consistent state and reuse it is going to be very valuable and necessary. The hyperparameter association with the scores, again, could be used as an optimization and so on. So with that in mind, we've been focusing on developing Flor, which is a system to capture and manage context across the machine learning lifecycle. And now that I've mentioned and started to talk about context, it's good to go into a little bit of a definition. So context is just enriched metadata. Here we have an example of a data set, and context is going to include metadata in the traditional sense. So we have schema, how many columns, what are the domains of the columns in the data set. We're also going to consider temporal context. So what did the data set, the models, other artifacts look like in the past? And for each point in time, what is the lineage provenance? Who are the producers and who are the consumers of the data? So this again, you can imagine if you are the producer of a model or the maintainer of a data set and you identify a defect or you update a new version, then it would be very constructive for you to be able to contact the consumers of your models. If you find a problem with your data set or your model, then being able to debug it means having the ability to leverage this kind of context. So the goals of Flor, first and foremost, are to enable tracking and reuse. So we need to be able to search over past versions of experiments so that we know what we have and share executables and resources with others. This means more than just keeping binary artifacts in a folder or putting them in Git. We also need to have the metadata. I don't just want to have the binary of the model. I need to know what the hyperparameters are, what the score was, when it was trained, who trained it, and so on. We also want to improve interpretability, so answering questions about the context of machine learning outputs. Again, if we just make this kind of raw presentation, it might not be very useful to the user. And finally, we want to offer both of these things, preserving agility. We don't want to get in the way of developers and interrupt the process. The whole point is to try to facilitate and abstract or automate away a lot of the repetitive work that is necessary for the proper recording and logging that would give us some of these guarantees. So one of the things that we've been focusing on a lot in the past with Flor is to give you a kind of pay-as-you-go feel. if you put in the least amount of effort, you get some benefit, and then as you start adopting and using it more and more widely, then you're able to capture more detail and get more context. So this is one example of a very coarse wrapping of code. You already have some code for training a model. You copy and paste it into the action, and you also do some work of plugging in the different inputs and outputs to the code. This is going to give you automatic versioning. So every time that you run the code to train a new model, there's going to be a snapshot of the code, and we're also going to keep track of what the input data was and what the output data was and everything like that. So you're going to be able to track the code, track the data, and track the models. As you saw in Tune, you'll probably want to do some hyperparameter optimization or hyperparameter sweeps. Then for each value of, say, number of estimators that you try, you want to associate that value with a score so that you know which configurations worked and which didn't, and so on. Then you'll also want to reuse intermediate artifacts. So this is a story about composing the experiment of different people. You might have someone who's a specialist in pre-processing data or preparing data for multiple people to use. In that case, you want to be able to inherit or import their artifacts, preserving the provenance or preserving the context. If there's a problem with the pre-processed data that you borrow from someone, you want to be able to get in touch with them. And you want many different people to be able to share it. And you want the directionality to be bidirectional, right? You want the consumers to be able to reach the producers and vice versa. And then the simplest way to wrap machine learning code is with a single decorator. And we'll see this in the tutorial. So with one Python decorator, Flor automates away much of the work around annotating and versioning experiments. And some key terms and concepts that I want to make sure to cover are, first, this is something that you'll see a lot in the tutorial, is the word of an artifact. Some examples are code, data, models, logs. These are just the kind of items that we would want to track by reference, and they're also inputs and outputs to actions, which I'll cover next. There's also literals, and some examples of literals are hyperparameters, configurations, and model scores. As you see, these are probably much smaller than the artifacts, and so these are going to be things that we're going to be tracking and managing, passing through Flor by value rather than reference. And then actions are just going to be executions of code. So one of the examples is run pipeline, and the action itself is something ephemeral, but the code of the execution lives in an artifact, and that's something that we're going to be tracking every time that the action is run. Next, we also have two different syntax modes. We have the most basic on the left, which is just a single decorator on a function. It'll automatically be able to extract what the outputs of the function are and be able to parse what the names of the inputs are for some tracking. So this will be able to associate values like the hyperparameters that you use for a model and what the score of the model is with a single decorator. And the basic syntax is going to compile down to the extended syntax where we are able to compose like arbitrary or experiments of many different steps where the end of one step or the output of one step becomes the input to the next. Here we're going to declare what the actions are, and we're also going to do a lot of the, almost you could say, plumbing, where we're informing Flor what the inputs are and how the actions connect from one another. And with that, we can get started on the tutorial. Here are some instructions that you can go to the website and follow them. Also, I thank you very much for listening, and if you have any questions, I'd be happy to listen. So the question was which language we support. Right now we support Python. Flor is actually like a Python domain specific language. We see that people do machine learning very often in Python, and that was a case that we wanted to cover. Thank you. So how do I see Flor relating to ground? Flor is actually an above ground application. It means flower. So. It uses ground as the system that tracks the context. So the user would use Flor to do machine learning business as usual, and then Flor has a lot of, like, it understands the semantics of machine learning, So it can automatically tell ground about the relationships between entities and automatically like capture and annotate the data of the artifacts involved. Thanks, everyone.